Our scripture reading this morning will be taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 17, verse 1 through 7, then verse 15 through 16. If you want to follow in the Pew Bibles, it's on your page 15, and in the light print, you find it on page 22. Let's listen to the word of God. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, "I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and be blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you and will greatly increase your numbers." Abraham fell face down, and God said to him, "As for me, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I'll make you very fruitful. I'll make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you, for your descendants after you, for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you." Verse 15 through 16. God also said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, God also said to Abraham, "As for Sarai, your wife, you are no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be called Sarah. I will bless her and will surely give her a son by her. I will bless her so that she will be the mother of nations. Kings of people will come from her." May the Lord bless his word this morning. Amen.
Girls have a place for you. How's that? Well, girls, we missed a Sunday, so we're still doing our love boxes here. So what did you bring in your box today? They packed their boxes because they're going to challenge me.
Okay, so my phone. I love my phone.
You love your phone. Anybody else love your phone?
No.
Anybody hate your phone? Okay, you see the difference in age.
Have Nutella because it's really good.
Nutella. Anybody know what that is?
Yeah.
Anybody like it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have the cross that I wear.
Okay, you still have your cross.
Then this was a cat toy that when my sister brought her cat over, but she's back at her house now, so she left this, and I love the cat. So.
You love the cat, so that represents the cat for you. Mm-hmm. Anybody else love pets?
Yes.
Pets?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, a lot of people. Okay, Adrian, what did you bring?
I want a picture of my family.
A picture of your family. Oh, my goodness, a big family, too. Now, here's a tough question. Anybody love your family? Sure. You may not love them all, but basically you love your family. And is there something you love? Do you have anything else, Asia?
No.
Okay. Tell me something that you love.
I love a car.
What'd you say?
I don't know. Tell me again.
I love popcorn.
Popcorn?
Broccoli.
What?
Broccoli.
Broccoli?
Broccoli.
No.
What did she say? She loves something. Okay. Now I have something for you. What's it say, Asia?
I love Jesus.
Is that true? And how do you show that you love Jesus? By coming to church. Reading your Bible? That's it?
Praying.
Welcoming new friends. How else? By doing good things. There's a lot of ways we could show that we love Jesus. But we need to tell other people about Jesus too, don't we? And that's... How do we do that?
Tell them to come to church.
we invite them to church, sure, because everybody doesn't come to church, so you can invite them to church, or you can invite them, what's coming up?
Easter.
The Easter, so you can invite them to the Easter egg hunt, right? So they can learn a little bit about Jesus as well. Now, I have one more thing for you. And you got to promise, don't put them in your mouth, okay? Fran, make sure. Okay? We have a coin. And Caitlin, why don't you read them?
Make me an instrument of your peace.
Turn it over.
Where there is hatred.
Hatred.
Hatred. Let me sow love.
Okay. So we can sow love, and if we sow love, that's because who loved us first?
Jesus
loved us first. So,
my mommy.
Okay, we'll go back in 1 minute. You have a heart to take to Gammy, and you have a coin, okay? And you can tell Grammy that you love her too, okay?
She does all the time.
You ready? So let's remember that we love many things, but Jesus is the most important thing to love, okay? Because it's his love that enables us to love other things. Thanks for coming down. Come on, we'll go back to Grammy.
Gail, on behalf of the diaconate, I welcome you as a new member of our church. And I give you your certificate and cards.
Thank you very much, and I'm glad to be with you all.
Thank you.
Gail comes to us through transfer of letter from Hamilton Square. So, Gail, we welcome you in the name of Christ. Our scripture lesson this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 4, verses 13 to 25. Listen as Paul reminds the people of the importance of faith. It was not through law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith. For if those who live by law are heirs, faith has no value, and the promise is worthless, because law brings wrath, and where there is law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham. He is the father of all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He is our father in the sight of God, in whom he believed. The God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he had promised. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words "it was credited to him" were written not for him alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness, for us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. May the Lord increase our faith today as we meditate on these words. What we need to know here is that Paul was addressing a mixed group of people. The Roman Christians were composed of both Jewish and Gentiles, of which the Jewish Christians considered themselves to be the true custodians of the faith. They could not understand that Christ was for all until they understood that God creates faith and faith has no human custodian. God shows no partiality. Therefore, God can create faith within a Gentile just as easily as God created faith in Abraham. Now, our churches today struggle with a similar issue, and that is faith between the old and new members. And I don't mean age, okay? Only God can create faith in the hearts of people. The church cannot create faith or transfer it to others. An unchurched newcomer grows in faith in ways that a longtime member never dreamed of. You have all witnessed that, I'm sure. Perhaps they were very outspoken about their story, that they wanted everyone to join their church. Or perhaps that new Christian that was on fire for the Lord just seemed to turn you off. Perhaps they had a phenomenal conversion story and you thought, well, I don't have a story to tell. You see, but God can create that faith in that new person as well as God can recreate faith in an older person as they face times of crisis in their lives. This is God's will. God can make all things and all faith new again. See, God's in the business of creating. Each new day, a gift from God. Each breath that we take, a gift from God. Each encounter with that special person that God put in our way, a gift from God. It's God busy at work creating the steps that we will take. God's busy creating opportunities for us, yet sometimes we're guilty of missing them because our eyes are closed. You see, God is the ultimate creator of faith, yet because of who we are and our human experience, some of us just can't accept that God is faithful. We live with so much distrust in our world that we don't even trust God at times. Don't worry, I know we're all guilty of this. We mistrust authority. We mistrust politicians. We mistrust the very people we're supposed to trust simply because we are exposed to those who have fallen from grace. From the Ponzi schemes to stolen mortgages to law enforcement beatings and unjustified shootings and even clergy who have taken advantage of children and church members. It's so hard for us to trust when we have experienced even a little bit of mistrust that when Scripture tells us to trust God, we're hesitant. To trust, we have to experience trust. You see, it's reciprocal. As we talked about love, we can love because Christ loved us. And the same goes for trust. So for some of us, it takes longer to learn how to trust God. Remember our story of Abraham and Sarah this morning? Our scripture reminds us of the promise God made to Abraham. Now, Abraham becomes righteous in God's eyes because he believes something that he knew was humanly impossible. If you remember the entire Old Testament story, you'll remember that Sarah, while she felt a little differently about it, she laughed. And who wouldn't at 100 years old? Be real. She laughed at the ridiculous thing of an idea that she was going to bear children. But yet, God forgave her and gave her children. Our faith requires a balancing act on our part. Have you ever been hurt by someone in the church? Your faith takes a hit, doesn't it? Have you hurt someone and that person thinks that all Christians act the same way? You have hurt their faith. We have to balance these things. When mistrust is present, we cannot grow our faith. For quite the opposite is true. We lose our faith.
We need to repair those areas of mistrust by turning them over to God, asking for forgiveness and moving forward ourselves to right our wrongs. And here's the tough part. We need to ask forgiveness sometimes. Not easy. We need to admit our weaknesses. We need to confess to one another our shortcomings and then begin to build trust once again. Need I say it's not easy? You've all been there. Nothing about our faith is easy, though. It doesn't mean it's not worth the effort. While only God can create faith, the church is responsible to cultivate that faith. No matter where a person is in their faith journey, the task presented to the church is to nurture it and to help it grow. It cannot grow on its own, although some people want to make you believe that it can be. For God created us to be in relationship. We were not created to stand alone. We need to be part of a believing church where God provides opportunities for growth. It's not a perfect environment, but I can guarantee you that it's better than what the world has to offer us. The people, well, they're not perfect. And you just might not be everybody's best friend, but it's a place where God continues to teach us and equip us so that we can live our lives out in His glory. Sometimes this requires great leaps of faith. Having faith in people who do not yet know God or know of the church. The example that jumps in my mind is when people reach out to the church for help and we give to them in faith, not knowing where their faith journey is. So that's what we're called to do. Sometimes we get taken advantage of. Sometimes we save lives. And hopefully, all the time, we spread the good news of God to those who need to hear it. How else can the church cultivate faith? The church needs to make promises just as God did to Abraham. The Lord promised Abraham many descendants and good land. Jesus Christ promises forgiveness and eternal life. And that should be the outline for our church promises to the community. As children are brought to church to be dedicated, you remember what the church promises to do? We promise to help raise that child in faith. As candidates come to baptism, the church promises to help them grow in their faith, to teach and to model faith to them, and to help them by providing opportunities for them to explore their God-given talents. Likewise, when we receive new members from other churches like today, we promise to enfold these new members with the love of Christ, to give them opportunities to grow and to serve in this place. There has to be promises made and kept between us, as evident in the reading of our covenant, which we'll do shortly together. That is how we cultivate the faith that God has created in our hearts. It's a give and take between people. It's a balancing act between people, where we complement one another, where we strengthen each other, and where we love each other with the love of Christ. So as we prepare to share in communion this morning, let us remember the promises of God manifest in the life and legacy of Jesus. Let us work together to cultivate our faith. Amen.
Amen.
As we close today, I'd like you to turn to a neighbor, and your greeting will be, because of Jesus, we can love one another. So, let's try it. Because of Jesus, we can love one another. Because of Jesus, we can
love one another. Congratulations.